Buonasera, grazie a tutti per essere qui. Come avete visto ci sono ovviamente motivi di sicurezza per cui abbiamo ritardato questo incontro. Io e Chris ci teniamo particolarmente a questo incontro e l'abbiamo voluto con tutte le nostre forze. Conoscete, se siete qui, la storia dei fondatori di RBSS. Noi lo abbiamo voluto soprattutto perché era un modo per esprimere il nostro sostegno, la nostra solidarietà, la nostra vicinanza a questo gruppo, a questo collettivo che ha messo a rischio la loro vita e hanno perso 4 dei loro amici e colleghi in nome della verità, in nome della libertà di espressione, in nome del diritto alla conoscenza per il loro paese e per una Siria libera e democratica.
On behalf of the entire festival community, I would like to welcome 2 of the founders of Raqqa is being slaughtered silently to the festival. We are honored, almost humbled by their presence and their and their colleagues' courage and conviction in doing journalism in the most atrocious of circumstances. Thank you.
Buonasera e grazie. Prego, we sit down. Grazie per essere qui. Io sono Francesca Caferri della Repubblica e voglio dire che è un onore per me essere qui questa sera a presentare questi ragazzi. E Chris e Arianna hanno già detto tanto, io voglio dire grazie a loro perché quando qualche mese fa loro hanno cominciato a pensare a questo festival e io ho mandato un'email alla Arianna ed ho detto dovrebbero venire loro. E da loro, da quel momento Chris e Arianna non si sono più fermati per avere loro qui sul palco e quindi è una giornata importante per tutti noi. Quindi grazie al festival, grazie a Abdalaziz Alhamza e Hussam per essere qui con noi stasera. Io voglio parlare il meno possibile perché voglio che parlino loro, però vi faccio soltanto un riassunto per quelli di voi che non conoscono tutta la storia di questo gruppo. Chi sono loro? Lui ha 24 anni, Hussam ne ha 27. Nella loro vita precedente erano degli studenti, in realtà Abdalaziz si è laureato in biologia, mentre Hussam studiava legge e come mi hanno detto facevamo le cose normali che fanno tutti quanti. Poi è arrivata l'ISIS a Raqqa e loro hanno aperto prima un blog e poi una piattaforma Twitter e Facebook, degli account Twitter e Facebook, che con il tempo sono diventati l'unica fonte di informazione per il mondo esterno, per tutti noi, per sapere quello che succede in questa città che è diventata de facto la capitale dello Stato Islamico. E quello che fanno loro, se voi non li seguite tutti i giorni, però è estremamente preciso. Loro twittano le foto con i nomi delle persone che sono state uccise, perché sono state uccise, le loro foto di prima, che cosa facevano. Cioè hanno una rete di informatori dentro la città che gli consente di dare informazioni con una grandissima precisione. Il risultato è che sono diventati un pericolo per l'IS. E loro erano in 10 quando hanno iniziato questo lavoro. Ora di quel gruppo di 10 ne sono rimaste 6. Uno dei loro compagni è stato ucciso pubblicamente sulla piazza di Raqqa, il primo, Ibrahim. E 2 sono stati legati ad un albero, gli hanno sparato alla testa e hanno lasciato lì i loro corpi. Altri 2 loro amici sono stati raggiunti in Turchia, nel loro appartamento, sgozzati, e i loro video sono stati messi su internet con la scritta «Così si muore silenziosamente». Io non vi sto dicendo questo perché amo l'orrore, vi sto dicendo questo per farvi capire che cosa rischiano questi ragazzi e che cosa rischia chi li aiuta, perché è morto anche il papà di uno di loro, due fratelli e un loro carissimo amico che si chiamava Naji, di cui dopo loro ci raccontano, che era scappato in Giordania. Poi quando loro hanno detto che il pilota, il famoso pilota giordano, non era stato bruciato nei giorni in cui sostenevano i giordani, si sono arrabbiati, lo hanno spedito fuori, lo hanno spedito in Turchia. Dopo qualche settimana gli uomini dell'ISIS l'hanno raggiunto e gli hanno sparato in faccia. Ecco, questo è quello che fanno loro, questo è quello che rischiano. E perché lo fanno? Ve lo raccontano loro adesso. Io gliel'ho chiesto ieri e loro mi hanno detto perché le nostre vite non valgono più di quelle dei nostri amici che sono morti. E io devo averli guardati un po' così, perché ho pensato, non si emozionavano, non così. E lui mi ha detto una frase che è l'attacco del mio pezzo di oggi. Mi ha detto: siamo diventati come i coccodrilli, non siamo più capaci di piangere dopo tutto quello che ci è successo. E questa è la loro storia. Allora, ci raccontate? Io adesso comincio a parlare in inglese perché è più facile la conversazione fra me e loro, è più fluida. So I'm going to switch to English because I'm going to start with the questions. So the first question that I want to ask to both of you, and you decide who's going to answer, is how did your blog started, and why did you feel that you had to do something like that?
Okay, first I want to thank all of you to be here, to come to here to us. It was so pleasure from the International Journalism Festival to invite us. We are so happy to be here with us, with you. I was telling that I thought 20 people will come and to listen to us. To have this number, it was so great. So thank you. So why we started our... Thank you. So first, I'll talk about our campaign, why we started, how, and all that things. So when the Syrian revolution started before 5 years, we decided to join this revolution. We didn't ask for a lot, we asked only for freedom. The Syrian regime changed everything. They started to shoot, to kill the civilians. So from the first day from the Syrian revolution, we knew that it's not a game, it's not a play. We will be arrested, we will be killed maybe. So all of us at least got arrested once by the Syrian regime. Everything developed in the Syrian revolution, no one helped us, international world, no one. So recently ISIS came to our city and they started to change everything. We were forced to flee, to escape from the city. I was wanted, I escaped in January 2014 after they controlled the city in 2 days because I was wanted, because I was covering the last clashes between ISIS and the Free Syrian Army. So I couldn't stay there, they were looking for me. Hussam stayed until June 2014 for 5 or 6 months. Then we thought that they discovered him, so we found a way to him to escape outside the city. At the same time, we still have a lot of friends, a lot of colleagues who are inside. In January 2014, when I escaped, then Hussam joined. In April 2014, we decided to launch this campaign to tell the world what's going on in Raqqa, because at that time, no one even heard about anything in Raqqa. International world, media, organization, international media. So we decided to make this campaign to draw the attention about what's going on in Raqqa, to show the reality of life there, to show the reality of ISIS, that there are millions of civilians who are suffering there and no one take care about them or care about them. So that's the reason why we started our campaign, to show the world what's going on.
Did you ever think that because of this campaign, all of this was going to happen? I'm talking about Ibrahim and the rest of your friends and Naji. I mean, were you expecting something like that when you started to become a target?
Okay. So first, when we started, we didn't think that we will lose anyone of our friends. So for us, we got arrested, we got tortured by the Syrian regime. But we didn't think that we will lose any one of us, one of our friends or whatever. After we started our organization in April 2014, after a month in May 2014, ISIS arrested one of our friends, his name Al-Mu'taz Billah. So I want to ask Hadi, our friend, he's with the laptop, for the PowerPoint, please.
Hanno portato delle foto e ora ve le faranno vedere.
So the second one. No, after that, number five, I think. Next, please. Next, please. Another one. Another one. Another one. Another one. Sorry for that. Another one, please. One more. Another one, please. So you're
gonna see all the pictures now.
Another more one. Another one. Sorry for that.
Okay. So yeah.
Stop, please. So here is Al-Mu'taz Billah, our first colleague. He got arrested in May 2014. And after 3 weeks, we got the news that that ISIS executed him in a public square. It was a change point in our campaign work. So we were thinking, shall we stop this work because we don't want to lose anyone else? Or we should complete this work? So we had a talk, we talked all of us. Our friends inside, they said that we should not stop. Our lives is not more important than his life. So we decided that we'll complete this work. And we knew that it's not an easy work or an easy thing to do. We know about all the dangers, so we decided that we will not stop. After that, we started our campaign officially. We decided that we should our best. We should fight for our city. It was a duty, it was not a war. It's our city, and we know that if we will not do this work for our city, no one will do it. So after that, ISIS got crazy because of our work. They spread a lot of security cameras in the city trying to catch us. There is a photo of us. Hadi, can you back to the slide number five? Yes, one before, please. So first, here, there is a tweet. I don't know if you can see it. ISIS fighters or ISIS supporters, they started to tweet that, look, right now we have security cameras all over the city, and we will arrest you. So they thought by that things they will stop us. But what one of our colleagues did, can you move to the next slide? So one of our colleagues, he went and he took a photo for their security camera, and we tweeted online, and we told them, okay, this is your security camera, what you will do? So we decided that it's a fight, it's another kind of fight. We couldn't carry weapons and fight them. So we decided that we should fight them online, and we knew that we affected them a lot, because they tried a lot to catch us. They did a lot of things in the city. They shut down all the internet cafe shops. They let 4 or 5 to work to control our work. These 4 or 5 are controlled by ISIS. Then they said that it's not allowed to anyone to have his own satellite internet in the city because in Raqqa city there is no mobile network. And they brought a car with radar to monitor the signals in the city. With all that things, they couldn't catch or arrest any one of us in the city. So what they did, they arrested the father of one of our co-founders. Can you move to the photo of the father, please, Hadi? Next. Yes, so here. They arrested his father and his brother and 3 of his friends. And then they started to contact him to tell him, okay, stop this work, stop this organization, and we will release your father, and we need the name of 3 of your friends, 3 of your colleagues who are working in Raqqa. So our friend, he was confused to choose between his father or his friends. He said that he will not give any name. After that, ISIS released an official video, 2 official videos. The first one, they executed his father, his brother here, and another friends. And can you move to the next slide, please? And the next video, they arrested the rest 2 friends of him. All that things because of our work. But these things, they will make a pressure on us to stop the campaign, to stop the work. Our friend was stronger than them. He said, they made me stronger than before. If I was thinking a bit to stop this work, I'll not stop forever. I'll keep fighting until I get my revenge. After that, they couldn't catch any one of our colleagues, so they had a long arms to Turkey. If we can move to the next slide. So in Urfa, a guy from ISIS, his name is Tlas, he came to Urfa, to Turkey, and he came to our friends Ibrahim with a green on the right. So he came to Urfa and he said that I escaped from ISIS and I don't have any place to stay. I don't have any money. So our colleague, he trusted him. He told him, okay, don't back to ISIS and I'll give you whatever you want. So he started to be a close friend. They lived together. And one night after 3 months, they were sitting together. He came and with another friends of him and they beheaded our colleague and his friend. All that things because of our work. Faris on the left, he's not a member of us. He was a friend of us. Only because he's a friend of Ibrahim, he got killed. After that, we decided the same, that we will not stop. We knew that we are doing a risky work, and we thought that Turkey is a safe place for us, but it was not. So they had a long arm to Turkey. They can go and back to Turkey in any time. After that, if we can move to the next slide. After that, Ahmed, it was in Idlib. He was traveling between Idlib and Turkey. Idlib, it's a city in Syria controlled by the Free Syrian Army. There before a day when he was deciding or thinking to travel to Turkey, they came and they shot him in front of his house, in front of his mom. So Ahmed is the brother of our friend who his father and his brother have been killed in the first video. So our friend lost his father, brother, and this the second brother, and later ISIS arrested his third brother in Raqqa, then they executed him. All the things because of our work. Recently, if we can move to the next slide, please. Recently, it was Najat Jorf, he's not originally from Raqqa, and he was not living in Raqqa. He was a close friend of us. He was like a godfather for us. If we had any problem with all our suffering, all this story, he was the one who was coming to us all the time to pick up, to take us to his office, to discuss, to say what we shall do, what's the best thing. He was our trainer. He was our movie director. He did a lot for us. He was teaching us how to do everything, how to report, how to write articles, how to do everything. We used to tell him uncle. All the activists, all the Syrians, most of the Syrians, they used to call him uncle. They knew how was Najat close to us. They threatened him a lot. And before his flight to France in one day, he decided to back from Istanbul to Gaziantep to say hi to our colleagues, to say hi to us in Gaziantep. And in the afternoon in Gaziantep, it's the second, or I don't know, it's one of the biggest Turkish cities. They assassinated him in the afternoon in the public square, in the city center, where there are a lot of security cameras, and they didn't discover the killers, the criminals, until now. All the things because of our work. With all the things, we decided that we will not stop. We lost a lot of friends, and right now we started to lose our feelings. So as she said when she wrote that we are crocodiles, yes, we are crocodiles. To have all the things, to lose all these people, all these friends, you should lose your feelings. But at least we have this thing, we have the hope. So that's the reason why we are keeping our fighting. Thank
you. Allora. Ci racconti, ce la fai? Ci racconti come si vive a Raqqa con l'ISIS? Perché noi ne sorry, I have to speak English. Scusate, ho sbagliato io. I was wondering if you can tell us. You cannot.
Okay, but I can't hear you. Okay.
Okay, allora, okay. Poi la ripeto al microfono.
Life in Raqqa with the ISIS.
Gli ho chiesto se ci racconta com'è la vita quotidiana a Raqqa con l'ISIS, perché questa è una cosa che noi viviamo da lontano, no? Viviamo queste immagini di terrore, però loro ci hanno visto i foreign fighters, hanno visto gli eccessi, hanno visto quello che succede.
First I want to thank everyone here and thanks journalism first of all to invite us here. So about the life in Raqqa, there is no life in Raqqa actually, because if I wanna do anything, I was afraid from ISIS, because ISIS changed everything in Raqqa, changed even whether even clothes, even I can't smoke, I can't drink, I can't go with my friend to anywhere. So everything is changed in the city. Women's, children's, no school, no university, nothing. So in the city of Raqqa now, we have no electricity, even 3 hours in day, no water, and every day warplanes targeting city. Actually, Russian warplanes targeting civilians in the city and said on media we targeted ISIS. So I can't do anything. No one can do anything without take a paper, take something from ISIS.
And I'll add something, if we can move to the Hadi, please, if we can move to the video with a long line, people are waiting. PowerPoint, please. So here there are a lot of women, a lot of men, a lot of civilians are waiting in lines to get some food. All the time ISIS are saying that Raqqa is the paradise. In Raqqa you will have whatever you want. These people are suffering there. They don't have anything to earn money. What ISIS first did, they shut down everything was linked with the Syrian regime, with the authorities. And the Syrian regime cut the salaries of the civilians. So you'll find teachers, lawyers, doctors, whatever, without any work to earn money. And everything got expensive at least 10 times in the city. So the people, they don't have anything to earn money. These people are suffering at the same time. ISIS fighters, they are getting salary in dollar. They are getting whatever they want, cars, women, sex, power, everything they want. If we want to talk about the life of women, if we can move to the photo, Hadi, the next one. The photo of the woman, how they are. So down, it's the normal photo. Upstairs, it's how the woman showed the life in Raqqa. They should cover all of themselves. They should be black and black. They can't walk along the street. They should walk with father, husband, brother, whatever. So these, in general, their lives. At the same time, several warplanes are bombing the city daily. Hadi, if we can move to the airstrike video, please. I think it's not available here. So at the same time, there are several warplanes are bombing the city. A lot of civilians have been killed by this airstrike. There is an anagraph for these civilians who have been killed. If we can see the anagraph, Hadi, please. This is the video of the airstrikes. No, not this one. Hadi, it's not this one. The anagraph. So it's okay. So
There is in a graph, we will show it later, it's talking about the number of the civilians who have been killed by the Russian airstrikes, by the international collision. So if we want to talk about January, I thought that there were more than 100 civilians who have been killed by the Russian airstrikes. At the same time, there are about 10 who have been killed by the international collision airstrikes. At the same time, ISIS executed a lot of civilians. They cut the hands of a lot of civilians. A lot of civilians had public executions in the city. So there are all these kind of the human rights violations in the city.
Ecco, apro solo una parentesi perché forse avrete visto da questi video com'è preciso il loro lavoro, come fanno vedere le cose quotidiane. Capite quindi perché danno così fastidio all'ISIS. Mostrare una fila per il pane quando questi continuano a dire che a Raqqa c'è tutto quello che voi volete è una contropropaganda fondamentale. I will ask you like this, because I know you're not here. But then you told me that civilians do not agree. Poi lo dico in inglese. Scusate, perché qui c'è l'eco e non si sente bene. Allora, le domande le facciamo dopo. Yeah, I'm just saying that because of the okay. of the sound, we cannot hear here.
Right now we can hear you.
Okay, now you can hear me? Okay. I mean, yesterday you told me that civilians do not support ISIS, don't like ISIS, but sometimes they are forced to join because that's the only way to survive. Because you also tweeted a lot about hope. I remember those wonderful tweets when you wrote about women. Because of the bombings, all the foreign fighters were gone and the women went to the windows without their veil. So is there hope in Raqqa?
Yes, actually for sure we have hope. And we, people who did this revolution, this Syrian revolution, and these people who lost a lot, they lost, let's say, everything. They lost friends, relatives, family members, they lost houses, future, everything. So these people, they will win one day. For the Raqqa people, the people who are still living in Raqqa, we are fighting for them. And there are a lot of civilians who are still living there and they are fighting. A lot of them, there are right now more than 1 million civilians who didn't join ISIS. Even if they will join, they will get whatever they want. These people, no one talk about them. These other people, the media, they are used to talk about or to talk that Raqqa is the capital of ISIS, and they forgot the million civilians. For us, Raqqa is the capital of the resistance. The people who are staying there, fighting there, they are doing the most important thing in the world. They are living in the riskiest area in the world. And for that reason, ISIS started to target the civilians, to recruit them to join ISIS by providing money, power, whatever they want. So we knew the risk of ISIS and they started to target the children. So we decided that we should not be only a media organization. So we started a lot of activities inside the city. So we started to spread posters and graffiti campaigns and we started to spread our own magazine. It's called Dabe. If we can move to the second slide, Hadi, please. Here is the graffiti campaign, the poster. These posters are talking no for ISIS, no for Al-Assad. The next one, please. Here is the graffiti campaign to build in the wall, fell down to ISIS. The next one, please. So here is a photo of our magazine. So we spread this magazine inside the city. ISIS when they controlled the city, they started to target the children. And the children, without any knowledge, any experience about who are they, who ISIS are. So it was so easy to recruit them. So ISIS did a lot of tents to make games, whatever, to the children. These children who are suffering, they don't have any schools, any educations, anything to have fun for 2 or 3 years. So ISIS started to target them, to let them join ISIS. And by these tents, to make to them games and whatever, and to give them money in dollar, to give them mobile phone, things that their families can't provide it to them because everything expensive in the city. And then they asked the children to join ISIS. And a lot of children unfortunately joined first. And they used these children as a time bomb. They sent them to training camps, then to the clashes, to the war lines, to use them to carry weapons, carry medicine, and the best situation to send them to bomb themselves to let the leaders and fighters escape. So by this magazine, we decided to target the children, a normal caricature with our accent, to aware the children, to aware their families, to not let their children go outside alone, to not let them go to ISIS schools, to not let them to talk with any ISIS fighters, because it's so dangerous. So to let the children know the risk of ISIS and to let the families know what's the risk of ISIS. So the people who are still there, our guys, our colleagues who are still there, who are fighting, who are doing all that things, and if they will be arrested, they will lose their lives. They are doing that things because they have hope that Syria will be a democratic, united, free country one day. And at the same time, there are a lot of civilians who are not a part of us, who are sending to us a lot of information, a lot of things on Facebook, on Twitter. They said that they can't do anything, because if they will do anything, they will be executed. A lot of them, they are sending to us greetings, and that's enough for us. That's it.
Talking about children, yesterday, can you hear me or it's okay? Yesterday you told me something very important. We are not only fighting ISIS, we are fighting for our future. Do you want to explain to everybody else?
Actually, it's our enemy, it's not ISIS, because before ISIS, we have the revolution against Syrian regime, Bashar al-Assad. So our enemy is Bashar al-Assad, because Bashar al-Assad killed every day 100 people, and if ISIS killed in the day 5 people, Bashar al-Assad killed 100 people in the same day. So a lot of people around the world thinking ISIS is a danger group in the world, but in Syria we have Bashar al-Assad. Until today, Bashar al-Assad killed around 500 people since 5 years, and a lot of people, around 300,000 people in the jail, 2 million in Turkey, in Lebanon, in Jordan, and in Europe. And in Europe here now, refugee crisis, but refugee crisis because Bashar al-Assad, because al-Assad stay until ISIS came, and no one knows Bashar al-Assad release these people from the jail, Saidnaya jail in countryside Damascus. So ISIS is bad group, it's not good, but ISIS don't have planes, don't have rocket. ISIS killed people because the people work against his propaganda, because people work against this ideology. But Assad killed people because people need freedom, people need democracy.
Yes, and if we want to talk about what we are fighting, So we don't fighting ISIS as a group or as a fighters. We know that they will be defeated one day. So our main problem is the ideology of the extremism. This ideology, ISIS started to spread it between the civilians, between the children. So our main thing to fight this ideology, and this is the reason why we are making this awareness campaign, the magazine, the graffiti, the posters. We know that they will be defeated, they will be kicked out one day. But the problem that we don't need, that we don't want a new generation of ISIS come from the children. So that's the reason why we are fighting this ideology. And it's so important to us to fight this ideology because these children are our children, the children of my city. And we don't want them to be criminals one day. So to inform them from right now, and when Raqqa will be liberated one day, they will have a lot of things to forget everything they had because they had a lot of bad things. And as Hussam said, he was talking about the Syrian regime, the brutal regime. So as the photo was showing the screen here, there were more than 180,000 civilians have been killed by the Syrian regime. This number is the documented civilians, the documented people with all the details, name, age, city, whatever. The real number is more than 1 million. And if we will look to ISIS, where is it? It's not that big number, it's around 2,000. And the media forgot the Syrian regime, forgot what they are doing. And right now in Syria, there is not only the Syrian regime and ISIS. We have a lot of bad extremism groups. We have Nusra, we have YPG who are doing the same thing. They started to disable civilians, to arrest, to burn cities, to burn villages. Yesterday, I was surfing internet and I found a photo and I put it here in this. I put in the PowerPoint. How if we can move to the same shit, please? Sorry. So here we are. So, and I didn't find photo with to Nusra Front to put it here. So other people are asking us, who's better or who's worse are? The Syrian regime, ISIS, YPG, Nusra. So for us, all of them, they are the same shit. I'm sorry for this word, but this is the reality.
I was waiting for the translation. Can you explain us, as much as you can, how you work? Because we saw the pictures with the security cameras, and we know that they know who you are, but you keep on posting pictures and sending information out of Raqqa. How can you do it? How do you work, and how did you change the way you work during the time?
Yes. Actually, first when we started with our normal things. We started to take photos by normal mobile phones, to board normal without any experience or without any training. So we were using social networks and not encrypted applications or whatever. But after what happened with our first colleague, Al-Mu'taz Billah Ibrahim, we decided to change our way. So we decided to be more careful. So all of our guys inside, they got online training. They got personal safety, information technology, digital security, and all these kind of trainings to be able to report, to work inside the city. Anyway, we are from this city, and we know every meter in this city. Most of them are foreigners, and they don't know the city a lot. We know all the details in this city. So we know how to work, how to take photos, how to report. They did a lot of things to stop our work. As I said, they shut down all the internet cafe shops, and the four or five who are still working are under ISIS control. And they banned any special or private satellite internet, and they brought this car to monitor the signals. With all these things, they try to stop our work. But we knew about all these news, all these new rules before they announced it. So we found many ways how to report. So we are two teams. Our first team, our colleagues inside, and we are 17. These 17 brave men and women, they are reporting from the city. They are sending to us informations, videos, photos, everything by encrypted applications. We had one encrypted application. It's only for us, for our group. We did it by ourselves to transfer the information. Our team outside, the second team, we are here outside, and there are a lot of colleagues of us. We are 10 outside. We are completing the work. So our guys, they can't write articles, they can't publish online. So we are doing this thing, to publish online on Facebook and Twitter, write article to publish it on our website, then to do interviews, conference, lectures, other things. So that's how we work. There were a lot of things, a lot of troubles in our work. What happened to our guy, to our friends, other things. We decided to hide in Turkey because Turkey was not a safe place for us. Right now, our guys are spread all over the world. Sorry, I can't tell you where they are right now. And I can't tell you a lot about our way, how we transfer informations from inside to outside.
But you do it. Now you're living in Europe. We're going to say only this. How do you see this, I mean, the crisis from Europe? I mean, you heard a lot about refugee, the reaction of Europe, the reaction of Germany, the reaction of the rest of Europe. Were you somehow disappointed? I mean, do you feel that your country and your revolution was betrayed or left alone by the international community or by Europe?
Okay.
Abdalaziz.
Yes. So, what happened in Syria, and after 5 years, a lot of civilians, a lot of people, they lost everything. They stayed there. And when the Syrian revolution started, we got a lot of promises from the international world that they will help the Syrian people, that they will help this revolution. In the first year, we didn't have ISIS, even Free Syrian Army, or any army group. It was only the Syrian regime. This brutal regime who was killing civilians every day. And the international world was watching them, watching the Syrian regime and doing nothing. These people who stayed there for first year, second year, the third year, then a lot of groups started to be. Nusra Front, Al-Qaeda came to Syria, then ISIS. No one thought that there will be something more horrible than Al-Qaeda, but ISIS came. These people who are living there, and there are rockets, barrel bombs, scouts, executions, all kinds of weapons. People from all over the world, they are fighting there. These people who lost families, friends, relatives, and they didn't find any way. They couldn't stay there. Let's imagine here in this beautiful, nice city. If there is bombing every day for 5 years, are anyone will stay here? For sure, no. Most of the people will try to leave, to escape, to survive with their lives. No one helped them. They asked other people to help, but no one did anything. They didn't find any way only to escape, to look for a new life. These people who escaped, they were forced to leave. They didn't leave to have fun or tourism or whatever. They had war in their countries. And these people, when everything will be okay, they will back to their countries. And all the people of the media right now are talking about refugee crisis. If they want to solve this problem, this crisis, let them finish or end the war in Syria. And all these refugees will back to their countries. And if they will defeat all these groups, they will not have any attacks anymore. They will not have any Paris attack. They will not have any Brussels attacks. In the same time, in Raqqa, in Syria, daily there is a Paris attack. And monthly there is 9 September. And no one cares about what's going on.
I'm going to ask you the last question, and then I will open the floor to the people. So if some of you want to ask any question, just be ready. from here, it looks like if Daesh, ISIS is something, ISIS is something that we cannot defeat, that it's really difficult. But yesterday you told me it's not that big of a deal. They can be defeated. I remember you told me the moment they finish their money, it's over. Do you really think, can you explain how can we defeat ISIS? I mean, why do you think that it is something that can be stopped?
Okay. So first, if we want to talk why the people are joining ISIS. So not all the people are joining ISIS because they believe in the ideology of ISIS or the ideology of the extremism. There are a lot of people who are joining to get power, to get money, to be famous, to have whatever they want. So even not the local, the foreigners too. I'm living in Germany, and I started to read a lot about the German foreign fighters who went and joined ISIS. There is one, he's called Dizzy Dog, or right now Abu Talha al-Almani, his ISIS name. So this guy, he was wearing T-shirt against Islam, and he was a rapper, he was singing all the time. And he got arrested by the German government or the German authorities 5 times for several reasons, stealing, problems, crimes, whatever. So this man was nothing in his country. When he joined ISIS, he had everything, power, money, 4 wives, 4 women, and then he took a lot of slaves out of Sabaya, sorry to say this word, from Yazidi girls. And if this man, Dizzy Dog, will publish any photo, all the German media will talk about him. All the people there, they will talk about him. Look, he published a selfie. It's an amazing thing. It's the first page of all the newspaper. So he was nothing in his country, and right now, look, he's a famous man. All the Germans are talking about him. I'm sure that there is all the Germans are knowing Dizzy Dog right now. So that's one reason. And a lot of people, they joined to get money, to get power, for that thing. These people who joined for these several reasons, they will not stay for a long time. So they used to say that we will stay and we will remain. So, but they were not. Once when they will have nothing, money or whatever, they will be defeated. They are not fighting for this ideology. Some of them, they joined, they are believing this ideology. Some of them, they came from Al-Qaeda, so it's mixed. But these people, they had a lot of fights between them, inside ISIS as an organization. And daily and monthly, there are a lot of executions to a lot of ISIS fighters who had problems with the leaders or whatever. So this group will not stay for a long time. And for them, they used to say that we will stay and remain. And it was what one of our colleagues did, that he rise up a paper in front of one of main ISIS headquarters, and he wrote that RBSS is remaining and staying. If we can see the photo, Hadi, please. Can we move to the PowerPoint, please? No, not this one, the one before. So this one. So, and in the end he wrote freedom forever. At the same time, he sent a message to the foreign fighters. It's in English. If we can move to the next slide. So foreign fighters, run away before it's too late. Raqqa is going to be liberated by today. I can't read that.
Or tomorrow.
Or tomorrow. So, we send to them out of messages. We send messages to the people who are living in Europe, in Western countries, in America, all over the world, in front of main headquarters, main things in Raqqa. These messages was telling them not to come to Raqqa. It was saying to them what's the reality of ISIS. So at the same time, we were not warning our civilians, the people who are staying or living in Raqqa. Our duty is to aware the people about the risk of ISIS.
Thank you very much. Now we have 20 minutes, and again, I'll open the floor to the questions. There are microphones. Barbara. Okay. So we'll finish 5 minutes before. Sta arrivando. C'era una domanda?
Okay.
Ah, okay. Allora iniziamo da lì e poi, scusa.
Vado. Okay, sorry. You
can
say.
Can you please stand up because okay. We cannot see you from here. Thank you.
Okay. You said YPG is the same thing as ISIS or Assad. But yesterday in this same room we had a presentation about what YPG did against ISIS and what. And why they fought against ISIS for freedom and democracy. And I want to ask you why you said it's the same thing. So that's the question.
Yes. So if we want to talk about YPG or PKK or whatever, so this group are trying to show to the media that they are a democratic, free group. But what they really are doing on the ground, a lot of crimes and a lot of violations. First, they started to recruit or to force children under 18 to join the army. They arrested a lot of Kurdish activists. They are coordinating with the Syrian regime, and we know that the Syrian regime is a brutal regime. And they are coordinating, and if you were seeing Kamishli, it's a city in Syria, they are in the same area, in the same place. So this group are doing the same. First, they control Tal Abyad's North Raqqa. And they didn't let our team to get inside, our team outside. They didn't let us to enter to report from the city because they know if they will enter, we will show their crimes and their violations. But they didn't know that we had members already there. So we started to report about them. They burned more than 80 houses, and they said that these people, they were living with ISIS and their houses should be burned. So they did a lot of things. They arrested a lot of people in charge of being ISIS fighters or living there with ISIS. So a lot of civilians, they didn't get any chance to leave or to escape. They are doing the same thing. Not only with Arab or... They are doing the same thing with the Kurd. There are a lot of Kurdish who are suffering. There are a lot of Kurdish who displaced from places, from their areas, from their cities, to not let their children go to this army and fight. So this group are coordinating with the Syrian regime. And to anyone who's coordinating with the Syrian regime, they are the same like Russian for us. So they are doing a lot of violations. And if you will check, there is a lot of reports from Amnesty, Human Rights Watch, but they are not like ISIS. They don't have the same propaganda to show it in the media. And if there is any journalist who will go there, they will not let him to walk alone, to walk freely, or to talk with the people alone. So they should be with them. So they are trying to show the people that we are the best and we are the one who should be supported to get money, to get weapons, to get other things. But in the reality, they are doing a lot of violation, a lot of crimes there.
There is another question here, Barbara.
You talked earlier about the bombing of Raqqa, the Russian bombing of Raqqa, and obviously the terror that causes among the civilian population. The US-led coalition is also bombing ISIS. Apart obviously from the impact on the civilian population, both Russia and the US-led coalition will say they're bombing because they want to weaken ISIS. From what you're hearing on the ground, are those bombings effective in any way? Are they actually managing to weaken ISIS?
Okay, so first, before I answer, I want to ask Hadi to go to the PowerPoint. There's a graph showing the number of the collision airstrike, all that things. If you, yes, that's one. So, I'll stand up. So, here if we want to talk, there are 10 civilians who have been killed by the collision airstrikes. At the same time, there are 6 who killed by some diseases. 2 have been killed because they have been arrested in the Syrian regime prisons. There are 113 civilians have been killed by the Russian airstrikes. 1 has been killed by the Turkish border guards, and there were 15 executions by ISIS in the city. So here, if we want to talk about the airstrikes, if we want to talk about the collision, they are targeting exactly headquarters. They are more careful than the Russian. What the Russian did, they are targeting the city center, the places where there are civilians. And they don't care if there is two headquarters, the first one to ISIS and the second one for civilians. So they don't care if they will target the civilian one or if they will target ISIS one and the civilians who are living in the next one will be killed. So until now, they didn't affect ISIS at all, the Russian. What the American did, they target mostly the countryside, the outskirts of Raqqa, and they killed a lot of ISIS fighters. And with that, what we saw with Jihadi John, Junaid Hussein, they are so important fighters in ISIS. And recently, they started to use the drones. These drones are targeting cars, trucks, something are moving. So they affected ISIS a lot. But what the Russian did when they started to enter the war or when they started to target or bomb Syria, they said first that they will come to fight the terrorism. They will come to fight the extremism in Syria. And the first airstrike was against the Free Syrian Army, an area where ISIS and Nusra far away 100 kilometers. So right now their strategy to defeat the Free Syrian Army, to tell the world, look, that the Syrian regime, Bashar al-Assad, are fighting the terrorism, are fighting the extremism after they will defeat the Free Syrian Army. So this is their strategy on the ground. So here is the map. It shows the airstrikes of, Hadi will tell us maybe later, he knows more about me about these maps.
Questions? Okay, there is a question over there.
Io volevo sapere.
Si può alzare, per favore, così la vediamo. Grazie.
Buongiorno. Volevo sapere chi finanzia l'esercito libero siriano e chi finanzia l'ISIS. Grazie.
Who's giving money to Free Syrian Army or ISIS, if we want to talk about these things? So actually, there is no one giving money or giving weapons. Because the international world, they are afraid to give anything or give any weapons. Only the Americans, they gave weapons to YPG, and recently they stopped supporting them. So the Free Syrian Army, they had fights with the Syrian regime, and by these battles, by these clashes, they got weapons, they got money, they got other things. To be honest, there are some groups who are getting fund from some countries, but this fund is not affected. Let's say they don't give them weapons or whatever, they give them some aids, foods, medical stuff, whatever. They give them money, but not that big amount of money. If we want to talk about ISIS fund, first, I'll talk a little bit about Raqqa quickly. So Raqqa city was forgotten from the Syrian regime. In the same time, Raqqa city, there are everything. In Raqqa, there is oil, there is gas, there is agriculture, there is antiques. Raqqa has borders with Turkey. So with other things, ISIS, they can earn money. They are selling this oil, gas to in the black markets in the Syrian-Turkish border to some mafias or whatever, so they can get a good bait. At the same time, there are kind of coordination between the Syrian regime and ISIS. So ISIS let the Syrian regime cars to cross from their territory and taking from them an amount of money for each car or each track. At the same time, Raqqa, there are the three main dams in Syria. These dams are providing 70% of the electricity and water towards Syria. And before the revolution, these dams, were providing electricity to Jordan and Lebanon too. The Syrian regime were selling electricity to these two countries. So they have everything. So they are selling the electricity, water, they are selling gas, alki-catcher, so they can get a good bait. And about their weapons, they had a lot of clashes, a lot of battles in Iraq against the Iraqi army, and they got a lot of weapons. The Iraqi army had a good heavy American weapons, and they controlled a lot of American bases there. So they had a good and heavy weapons.
More questions? They want to show you a video before we finish, but is there something that you want to say?
All our speech we were talking about suffering or whatever. So we did this video, our organization did this video, will come soon on the screen. It's kind of funny video, we did it. It came after 1 year when ISIS came to Raqqa. Had if we can play this video.
Happy birthday to you, my friend. Happy birthday.
Happy, 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 happy birthday. Happy, 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 happy birthday, my friend.
Tell us all what you want, and then shout out your name. Close your eyes for a surprise. Good one, and then you hear.
نحن
أحفاد
أبو سعد
الزرقاوي
I think this is the best end for this meeting. I just want to thank Hadi for helping us back there. Grazie. And thank you very much to Arianna and Chris once again for having you here. Thank you to you for coming and showing us what's journalism, what's citizen journalism. Thank you for being here. Grazie. Raqqa has been slaughtered silently.
Thank you for you to coming here.